to the meeting of the Joint Health Scrutiny Committee between Wirral Council and Cheshire West and Chester Council. Do we have any nominations for the chair this evening? Jet, Councillor McManus being in Jet? No? That's a full board meeting.
Typical, but I was uploaded to school. First of all, before we go around the room and introduce ourselves, I'm going to ask, and perhaps we need to make a little bit of room around the table. There are two councillors here that are not part of our group, but I will be inviting them, certainly Councillor Gilchrist, to speak, because both are ward members of Eastham. And obviously, you know, Eastham practice is one of the practices that that is potentially going to be affected, and particularly in the South Wirral area, which is where I will meet it really. So, if Councillor Gilchrist and Councillor Carew would like to squeeze in. And although both won't be able to ask questions, they may want to take part in the debate, and that's fine. Okay, so this joint committee is requested to make the protocol for the establishment of arrangements for joint scrutiny in Cheshire and Merseyside. I'm told there are no apologies for absence tonight. Are there any members' declarations of interest?
On GBA single practice and wrong and marriage position of energy's really thank you.
As of the new year, I'm working for the hospital's consultants and specialist association.
Congratulations. Okay, if we can go around around the room then. I'll start with myself, Julie McManus, Board Councillor for Bits and St James, and Chair of the Adult Health and Care Committee.
My name is Graham Hawkinson, I'm Director of Care and Health with Borough Council and CCG, with the Health and Care Commissioning. I'm here to just provide technical advice to Julie McManus.
Councillor Paul Gilchrist, a representative from Eastern Ward, a guest of this committee, thanks to the invitation from the Chair. I'm Governor of CWP, and therefore declare that as an interest.
Councillor Chris Carragher from Eastern Ward, and also the Dutch Banks for Children in Sweden.
Sharon Jones, I'm from Eastern Ward, and also the Dutch Banks.
I'm Sue Wells, I'm a Wirral GP and Chair of the OSC.
Good evening, I'm Holly Cowan, Managing Director of the Wirral Health and Care Commission.
I'm Simon Banks, I'm Chief Officer of the NHS Wirral Clinical Commissioning Group, Wirral Health and Care Commission, as well, and therefore the Council Officer for the Health and Care System.
Good evening, I'm Jackie Evans, I'm Assistant Director of the Legal and Health Care Group.
Councillor Val Armstrong, Councillor with Cheshire West and Chester Council, and Chair of our People Overview and Scrutiny Committee.
I'm Councillor Margaret, Parker, I'm Vice Chair of the People Overview and Scrutiny Committee, and I'm also the Shadow Cabinet Member for Children and Families.
Councillor Val, Cheshire West and Chester, I'm Deputy Chair of the Overview and Scrutiny Committee.
Patrick Sebastian, Committee Officer.
I'm Nikki Shore, I'm from Legal Services in Wirral.
Okay,
Well, the running order will be, Jackie, you're going to give us a presentation, I believe. Dr. Cameron, you're also going to give us a presentation. Did you want to do those separately and then with questions at the end of both presentations or afterwards, whichever suits?
I'll introduce Jackie and then she'll do the presentation.
Okay.
And take the questions at the end, if that's okay with everybody.
That's fine. Thank you. Over to you.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for having us here and, for this joint meeting, because certainly the plans and the proposals that we have do affect our colleagues in Cheshire, and particularly with those four locations in Nest and Wilson and also Easton. Essentially, what we'd like to do is give an overview of what our proposals are during the consultation period. And the consultation, obviously, as you're aware, has been ongoing since the 20th of September. Nationally, urgent care is under the spotlight. And you can't open any media or printed press without seeing something about urgent care. NHS England are encouraging the development of urgent treatment centres. They're encouraging the development of extended access for GP and nurse appointments, and also looking at an overview and improvement around the delivery of the 111 service. Wirral is no different to any other system, and therefore, based on the NHS guidance, which I've alluded to, we are proposing the development of a primary care facing urgent treatment centre based at the Arabon site. The reason for this is multifactorial and based on guidance from NHS England around the 27 parameters for an urgent treatment centre. That includes increased access and rapid access to diagnostics, to radiology, blood tests, etc., and also increased access to emergency consultants where required a patient deteriorates. Our proposals are only those patients who clinically need to be seen at an urgent treatment centre are seen there. And so the concept that all patients will have to go to the Arabon site is not what we're proposing. We are looking, therefore, in the community of how we deliver urgent care and how, what our offer would be to be to our patients, our population, 300,000 population within the rural community across the 4 wards. We recognise that there is considerable variation across Wirral in the delivery of urgent care in the community. And we want to improve that community offer, to improve the delivery of urgent care services to our patients, offering urgent care on the same day and walk-in book appointments, dressing, clinics, and the walk-in element for the 0 to 19 and for children. The only element that we are proposing to change is the walk-in element for adults. And that will be replaced, the proposal is that will be replaced with extended access appointments with nurse and GP appointments for the adult population. Jackie has a presentation which I'll pass over to Jackie so that she can go through more of that. But that in a nutshell is what we're looking at. We'll take questions and inquiries and debate at the end.
So we have brought some composite slides of people that I find it helpful, and then we'll also put a couple of the projects in as well. Just give them a touch for you to have those. Well. Thank you, Patrick.
Thank you.
I guess mindful that some people in the room have been close to some of these proposals and have been to at least one, but more presentations. But don't want to make assumptions that some of the colleagues and people here tonight from Cheshire may not be as familiar. So please bear with us if some people have heard some of these messages before. And I'm also mindful that you've had quite a lot of information circulated. So we'll try to condense the main points that are particularly pertinent to those patients, those residents that straddle our borders, and understand what the issues are when we get to that conversation, if that's okay for people. So we've probably got about a 20-minute presentation that focuses around process, what our considerations are, and just reinforces some of the Cheshire West activity that we can get underneath the skin on. So the first one, just to pick up where Paul left off really in terms of why are we doing this? So for us, like all of the systems, this is absolutely about how we improve the vision of emergency care for people of Wirral, but being mindful of those people that cut across into Cheshire West. Paul has described very high level what our intentions are with those proposals about starting an urgent treatment centre on the Arrow Park site, and we absolutely want to create a single front door so we can really streamline the current services. For Wirral, when we've looked at activity, 47% of the people who attended A&E last year could have been seen in the community and elsewhere by either a pharmacist, a nurse or indeed a GP. They absolutely did not need to go to A&E. So we clearly have got a challenge about how we create a single front door, how we address behaviour change and actually get a better message out there. We also want to address the issue that we have around variation. So in the community at the moment we have three walking centres and three minor injury units. They are nurse-led services, they offer slightly different services and they're all open slightly different hours. And we recognise there's not a nice neat offer that's consistent across Wirral, and so depending upon where you live, it depends upon what access you get to the walking minor injuries. So part of this offer is to move to a consistent offer that supports the four localities within Wirral, and it's a very clear message to people about how they access urgent care. Big driving force about how we ease pressure on Wirral's only A&E. Like all other systems up and down the country, we are not meeting consistently our 4-hour performance standard in terms of waiting time. And if anybody has recently been up to A&E at our park, very often you'll see ambulances queuing well in excess of an hour, very often to turn around. When I go into A&E and walk around there, often see people, old frail people on trolleys, in corridors, waiting to be counted over and seen by the clinicians. Totally unacceptable. That overcrowding backs up, and then for many people with low mobilities, they're waiting very often well in excess of that 4 hours. So big driver for us is about actually how we support A&E and use the pressure and help reduce that impact on people's turnaround times. It's a clear part of this work. But absolutely, this is not about putting everybody up at our own park. This is about how we make best use of our resources and how we support that local offer. We have a cost envelope that we need to work within, and that is the existing cost envelope that we have for urgent care services. The only extra money we have is 1.8 million for Wirral, which all systems have additional funding to ensure that local residents, local patients have access to GP nurses 8 to 7 days a week. For Wirral, that amounts to 1.8 million. So that's the extra part that when I go through the next few slides, you'll see how we're linking with that national development. But just to stress, whilst we need to make best use of resources, free up GP time, free up ED clinician time, where people did not need to see that those people, they could have gone to a pharmacy, could have seen a nurse, and this is not about a cost-cutting exercise, so we need to stress that. Just a couple of other messages on that slide before we move on. When we went to talk to people, either at stakeholder events, workshops, or indeed during this consultation, we've heard two strong messages. One of those is that people tell us they go where they go, either to A&E or to walking centres, because they can't get through or to see a GP or a nurse when people believe they need to see it. Certainly, same day, it's very difficult for many people. And we have another strong message that said, actually, we're really confused about what's available, when it's available, where we're supposed to go. So in these proposals, we've tried to listen long and hard to those two key messages and do something with that. Just the plan we addressed then, this addressing the variation, bringing care closer to home. Paula mentioned we are trying to look at a consistent offering of proposals we're going to consult with about having replacing the walking element from the 3 walking and 3 minor injury units with a consistent local offer, which I'll describe in a moment, in the 4 localities in Wirral, which would be Bentley Care, Wallasey, South Wirral and West Wirral. And tonight we will clearly focus on the activity in the South Wirral, which offers up into Cheshire West. So very briefly, the next couple of slides, I'm not going to dwell on this, just a little bit more information for you about the drivers for change, a little bit there about why we're trying to help that pressure on A&E, I'm not going to repeat that. See the very poor performance that we currently have. We've tried in that bottom left-hand box to just illustrate for people the variation, the current walking centres, minor injuries in terms of opening hours. And then on the right-hand side, we've tried to just show very high level, a little bit of analysis about where people, from which GP practices people are using those walking centres and minor injuries. and you can see that, looking at the top, 10 practices account for almost 40% of the usage of the walking centre and lounge injuries. There's a lot more detail in this in your packs, but broadly speaking, what we see is a pattern of the GP surgeries surrounding those walking centre and lounge injury units tend to be the most take, or the most activity comes from those practices. So, in terms of the consultation, so clearly we want to ensure that this is meaningful, and we've actually been doing work since as far back as 2009 in Wirral, but we've had quite intensive work since over the past 18 months, 2 years, really intensive workshops, stakeholder events, with clinicians in the room, with Health Watch, with local young people, with councils, etc., to really get underneath the experience that people have of urgent care and understand the real issues. So just on that slide, that going through that in line by line, what we've put on our website, and I know you've had sight on, is a very detailed case for change, which analyses all the activity and the feedback that we've had from those workshops, and breaks down to how we got to the proposals. We've also published, again, we've had sight on our frequent questions, which we've been updating and answering each week. We've done quality impact assessments, again, you've seen those, they're available. And just to emphasise that we have had Health Watch and the Patient Advisory Group a big part of this development and engagement process. Again, to note the workforce issues, we're no different than any other system up and down the country, and we do recognise that workforce, if there's any change, what we don't want to do is create a workforce that is anxious about the change. This is absolutely not about job cuts. The worst case scenario is that we may be asking people to work in slightly different locations if the proposals go ahead. But just to advise people, we've had quite a few dedicated staff workshops throughout this process during the consultation itself and attending individual staff groups. And I have to say, by and large, staff teams have been very, very constructive and given us some really helpful points of consideration going forward. So, governance process. You'll be aware that we have, you know, like any other system, this approach, we have to be subject to the NHS England Service Change Assurance process, which is extremely detailed. And we have had to submit all documentation, all analysis, everything that we've considered from the workshops and from the activity before we have approval to proceed from NHS England. So that was received before we went to consult back in September. The transformation programme that oversees this consultation and the work to date does feed into our executive management team, who have oversight as well as ensuring that the CCG governing body and the Joint Strategic Commissioning Board have been maintained, kept up to date with regular briefings. Also wanted to just mention that we, as part of the independent review, we've been working with the HSE and Clinical Senate, who did a day's visit a couple of weeks ago, and we are waiting for their final report in that we will take duly into account as part of our final considerations and recommendations. And they have independently looked at, again, case of change or our activity analysis, and spent time visiting services, walking around A&E and the walking centres, and have met across the system exec teams to question and understand the considerations and issues. So we have their findings, and that will be very helpful for us as part of this process. Quick slide on communication and engagement with people. So as I said, dates back as far as 2009. Just a snapshot there, just as a reminder that we've done significant major stakeholder and workshop events with key stakeholders since 2016. Just on the left-hand side there, I'm not going to go through that in detail now, but just a few examples so you can see the themes that we were picking up as part of the 2016-17 engagement. You can see how those themes have carried on as part of our ultimate proposals. So you can see some things that have been debated as far as a few years ago. So, just to move us into then, the proposals on the table. commented on it, but just to say that we have a national mandate NHS England, like all the systems do, to deliver as part of their intention to improve urgent emergency care, develop an urgent treatment centre. Commissioners were asked to consider the local context and consider whether which of the two options we have on the table are the best for the local situation. So clearly we can make recommendations to site those on an acute site or in the community. And we've had to weigh up and deliberate based on the activity, based on the current behaviours and culture, based on feedback about where we best site that. Paul has already covered that the decision with our intent over analysing all of that, our recommendation for the reasons that we spin on that slide down that left hand column. We made a recommendation which governing body supported that decision to site the urgent treatment centre for Wirral on the Iron Park site. And that was about creating that single front door, really protecting, supporting AME, so that, that is absolutely there for those people who really need it. GP-led, primary community services running the urgent treatment centre, redesigning the front door so that people, if they still people want to walk in to an urgent treatment centre, are seen by those GP nurses, and clearly having rapid access into ED to specialist consultants and further diagnostics as required. Okay, so I think I'm not going to draw that slide anymore. I think we've probably covered that, but clearly the intention of our two proposals cite that the urgent treatment centre for option one could be open 4 hours a day, and for option 2, up to 15 hours a day. And then, what's the local offer that supports, that sits alongside the urgent treatment centre? The local offer, as I've said, is about ensuring that we address the issue of variation and address the issue that we have of people saying we don't have access to GPs when we need it and we're confused about where to go. So we want to replace the current 6 walk-in elements in those walk-in centres and libraries with an option in the 4 localities. The detail of that is sitting with those ticks on the left-hand side. So for us, this is about having same-day access to GP and nurse appointments. So this 1.8 million, the national mandate to ensure people have access to GPs and nurses 8 to 7 days a week. We want to be part, make sure that it's part of this urgent care offer and people have access to a GP or nurse in the same day in their locality, in their neighbourhood. I've got a slide in a moment on that to give you some short about assumptions. Just bear with me on that. But our intention is that actually we want to make sure that some of those same day appointments are available in those 4 community services from where they're based. And we want to make sure that they're available. So that replaces the current walk-in waits for adults to see a nurse. Bear in mind, the current offer are only nurse-led. We're saying no longer for adults walk-in and wait to take a look where they see within half an hour or 2 to 3 hours, but actually make contact through the surgery, through 111, to get access to same-day GP or nurse appointment in your local area. Then in terms of replacing the other elements of walk-in, when we've done the analysis, 27-28% of people who use the walk-in work on children's services. Also, half of the people who used AME last year that didn't need to go to AME were for with patients and children. So we clearly need, for both council and the local, and also supporting that AME if people not having to go to the urgent treatment centre or to AME when they don't need to do that. We want to keep a local strong offer for children's services. Bear in mind feedback we've had about the need for parents very often to want to quickly go in somewhere. We want to retain both proposals on the table, include a walk-in and a bookable option locally for those 4 centres, those 4 service areas for children small to 19. 21-22% of people who use the walk-in management assistance for ongoing consider wound care. Most of those, 95% of those, were bookable appointments, they're planned appointments for ongoing support. We want to say stop the walk-in, but keep that local offer, but we'll make them bookable, including access same day bookable. So we hope that actually that improves it for people who don't have to walk in away. And one lady was telling me in one of the consultations last week, she has to have ongoing permanent dressing room care. and she has to go to the local walking way, anything booked her, she's waiting for us 5 hours. So actually, for many, many people, we believe that having a bookable appointment for dressing and wound care actually helps people, reduces the lottery of walking the ways and seeing that work. So our belief is that it does improve. It's important to just ensure that people are aware that any of the services currently provided at those walking and mind injuries, including sexual health, lobotomy, etc., they're not affected. We're only talking here about the walking elements. We've also just put a comment there about pharmacists. We absolutely recognise that we have got significant numbers of people who are not using the local pharmacists, of which we have 93 in Wirral. They're going to nurse or GP appointments. Again, we need to make sure that we're freeing up those really important nurse and GP appointments with pharmacists where they can be used. So we've got a challenge on our hands about how we get that message out there. And finally, just want to say on that slide that we deliberately did not go out to say where we believe those four local service hubs should be based. We deliberately did that because we didn't want to make assumptions. And in the consultation material with the nursing team, we asked 5 questions against people to write. They include things around distance from home, access to public transport, parking, etc. And we will duly take account of what comes back from the public in determining whether the local services are based. I think it's really important to probably make this group aware that we will not be surprised at all if residents, we're going to focus on Southwell tonight, residents in Southwell will come back with a very strong message that they're very ready to Easton, and we wish to see the local offer continue from Easton. And we won't be surprised. And that for all the commission is not an issue, but we don't want to make those assumptions. Okay, we're almost there now. So just a quick one on extending access, if people want to understand a little bit about our assumptions. So extending access, this extra GP and nurse appointments is driver nationally that all systems up and down the country want to ensure by April that people have access to same-day GP and nurse appointments by April next year. Currently in Wirral, we have 21 practices offering at the moment an additional 720 appointments. So additional appointments between 6:30 and 8 in the weekdays and Saturday and Sunday. So we're not there yet, but we're moving towards it. And local federations are working well with us. What we put in that pink column is just to define for you what the extra appointments actually mean. So by April next year, we will be increasing and doubling the appointments available for you. So at the moment, we have extra 720 GP appointments. By April next year, it is our intention to have an additional 1,440 GP and nurse appointments available in Wirral. Well, we've been on number crunching, and we've been very conservative with the issue that we don't get all the behaviour change immediately right, and we don't necessarily get all our communication immediately right. We play safe. But we believe that after absorbing the current walking for adults that we are saying will be replaced by same-day access to GP or nurses, rather than walking and wait with a nurse appointment or go up to A&E, we say, make a phone call, book online, you will have access to a GP or nurse. Or indeed, you can still go to the urgent treatment centre. We still believe there will be 652 appointments available after we have absorbed the current walking activity guidelines. So we do believe that is robust, and we are working with federations to develop that at the moment. So that equates to about 90 a day. Okay, and then just got a couple of slides now on activity, and then we'll draw breath for people to ask questions. But I did want to put some of the Cheshire West activity up there. It's not the easiest slide in the world to see at a distance. You have had all these impacts, but this is just looking at last year's walking centre activity from Cheshire West. So you can see there were 3,645 attendances, and you can see, interestingly, where that breaks down. So we are, I think, assuming most of that is Eastern, which most of it is, but you can see there's still significant 39% of the attendances went to the Arab Heart Walking Centre, and 10% actually also went to Victoria Central. And when we've been able to talk to the public and talk to staff at Victoria Central, we've had a clear message that says actually we know that people are being directed from Elsmere Port when they're full. So we do need to understand there are some connections here with the Cheshire West activity and services as well. So it just breaks it down to show the three areas of Cheshire West residents and where they're going. And then you can see a further breakdown there that when we've analysed where people went, what they went for, 26% had to be referred back to their own GP. 9% had to be redirected to our own part because it was part of fracture picking, x-ray, etc. So they had to go to our part regardless. And then if you look at the top right, 21%, which mirrors very similarly really what we found for rural residents, attended for addressing the wound care. Again, we continue to say that's part of our local offer. And you can see there 21% was 0 to 19. Again, we want that's part of our local offer. So we've got about approximately 1,800 attendances from Cheshire West last year that were appropriate to see a GP or a nurse. And that's the group we need to focus on about what's good for those people, whether it's urgent treatment centre, whether it's bookable appointments, what's the offer for Cheshire West that offers up every rural. And then you can see we've just included a slide there that shows the uptake against GP practices from Cheshire West. So you can see there's quite a lot of usage of footfall from Neston areas, Great Sutton, but you can see how that breaks down on that right hand side and providing the breakdown for people as well. The bottom red box just shows the A&E usage, so last year Cheshire West patients going to our park, just shy of 5,000, rural patients going to the Countess, 1,334. Okay, last couple of slides I'm not going to dwell on too much because it just gives you a further breakdown of what we described. We looked at quarter one, 18-19, because we wanted to really just check there was no big deviation from last year's activity, as we need to bear in mind. It's pretty much mirroring what we found. We also did this just to reassure people because we know that Easter had some closures last year. So we looked at 16-17 data for Easter, what we had then on 17-18 part year, and we've done this final sense check quarter one this year. And there's no huge deviation in activity messages to share today, but we've done that as a belt and braces to just check. So you can see the breakdown of why people attended. And you can see that for many that fits in with that many people could have seen a pharmacist or something. Both inputs, yes, that are on the difference, this one. And again, we've had all this just sort of shows our assumptions about how we absorb the activity. I'm not going to draw on that, but if you want to ask questions later, we can. We know that overall, between Wirral and Cheshire West, there were just shy of 110,000 attendances in our walking centres and minor injuries. And we've just tried to illustrate there our assumptions when we group that we do believe that what we have on the table in those proposals does paediatrics and dressings, which is the bulk of those attendances, keeps that in a local service. We're not suggesting we have to go to the urgent treatment centre. And you can see that 38,700 attendances for adults who went to see a nurse, we are saying would be appropriate to have same day access to GP or nurse, or indeed it's out of hours to the urgent treatment centre. We've just put the pharmacy figures in of those 5,000 as well. And finally, the other thing I want to just draw from that slide. By starting the urgent treatment on the other park site, one of people say, well, what about footfall, what about parking? Conservatively, worst case scenario, we're only looking at an extra 30 people a day if option one is the preferred option of a 24-hour urgent treatment centre, and the full local services being open to 8 hours a day. And if option two is the preferred option, which would be a 15-hour urgent treatment centre with the local services open to 12 hours a day, we're looking at no more than a footfall of 20 people a day. So we're not talking significant. And then just in the packs, again, on the draw list, and this is the last slide, we've just provided for people so you can see the usage from our practices and down the south wall patch of the end traffic, primarily on the big impact of south wall. You can see this south wall GP practice analysis broken down, just so that's there as a full suite of information. And then Patrick, if you could just go to the last slide here, please. So in terms of our next steps, consultation concludes tomorrow, and we will then take a period of time to duly analyse all the feedback and all the setup start, no decisions have been taken. We do need to hear from people, and we are expecting a couple of different proposals to put forward. We need to take due time to consider those in full before we make final recommendations to governing body. We've put on there that it's our intention around April to go to governing body, but that's not in tablets of stone. We need to give due consideration to what comes in. At this point, it's unknown because we're still in the last 24 hours of engagement. And we will clearly come back over this group of post decision to talk through proposals and next steps. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Thank you. So, any questions?
I'd like to start by looking actually with a comment probably rather than a question about the consultation. I'm aware that it's been quite a long consultation with the stakeholders at the beginning, and you've spoken at various community meetings, which sounds really good. It's the content of the consultation. I would say it looks as if you've made up your mind, and that leaves me feeling that this isn't really a general consultation, and it doesn't meet the governing principles of consulting at a formative stage. And I refer you to page 14 of your document, where you give your option one and option two. A, there's only two options, and they're both very similar. B, you give option one, and it's all the advantages, and no, all pros and no cons, and you give option two with quite a long list of cons. So clearly, it looks to me that.
Thank you, and I can understand the very coming from what I will say is the proposals that I put on the table just the results. That we went out to consult with. They were based on various different engagement exercises that we've had over some years, going back to as far back as 2009, and then more recent years, 2015-16, having value stream analysis workshops around what it is that our stakeholders and our patients, having patient groups there, what it is that they're looking for, what it is their concerns are around urgent care and the delivery of urgent care, and what it is that they would like to see going forward. So those proposals came about from all of that data coming through to us. However, what I've said very publicly in this forum, as well as in the public forums that we've had, and to local general practitioners, is that we are open and welcome to take ideas and questions and queries and some of the proposals from our stakeholders, from our GPs, from our population, and listen to what's being fed in to help us to shape what we deliver going forward. No decision has been made, and I can guarantee that to you, that no decision has been made. What you have in front of you were the proposals based on that, those workshops. But through this exercise, we have had a lot of comments coming in. And we will take time once the consultation closes tomorrow to review all of that, to look at all of that, and then to decide how we go forward.
So there's a direct question about meeting the governing principles. Mm-hmm. So before any consultation goes out, it has to be cleared by NHS England. We've also sought advice from the independent review panel as well. We advise the Secretary of State on subsequent referrals outside of the scrutiny committee to pass them on. It satisfied their criteria around that. I do take the point you made about the options around the emergency treatment centre. Unfortunately, there are no options around the emergency treatment centre, apart from the fact we have to have one, and the minimum standard is 12 hours. So what we're saying to the public is, we'd like to go further than 12 hours, 15 or 24, but then how do you want your community services organised thereafter? So the question is, and we probably haven't you know, as you say, it's articulating this in terms of what an urgent treatment centre does. What do you, as a public, want to do with the remaining eight, or doing maths quickly, 12 hours of that? So, has been quite a bit of pre-work around this, pre-consultation work, and I think it would be fair to say we perhaps haven't got that across fully in the document that NHS England have cleared for us.
Yeah, if I could just add to that, in the work up to this position, various other options were looked at, and we're not allowed to put an option to the public that is not feasible, that cannot be carried out. So some of those were eliminated because we couldn't carry through with them. So, but perhaps that didn't come across so well.
Yeah, I do appreciate that you're not, that would undermine the consultation,
yeah,
if people thought it was not achievable in any way.
Yeah.
We have, if people ask questions on the website and in the packs, you have got the options that we consider to be discounted and fees and so on. But that is in the pack.
Thank you. I was extremely impressed with the consultation documentation themselves, and I'm potentially less impressed with the case for change, which I'll come to shortly, but I just draw back to the comments that's just been made. It says that no decision has been made. Lots of decisions have been made, haven't they? Because, for example, an option one that was looked at in the original November 2017 proposed an urgent treatment centre at Harry Park over 12 hours a day, 7 days a week, with no change to existing walking centres. A decision has been made to exclude that, hasn't it?
Yes, and the feasibility study perhaps in this brief and ask questions.
So it seems we may exclude that. Why is it not feasible to have considered that option?
Because that would constitute over-provision. So we are already over-providing, not only for our own population, but for the population of West Cheshire, in terms of access to urgent emergency care. And that clearly isn't working, and the system actually needs redesign. The mandated aspects of this are extended GP and nurse bed appointments, which is the 1.8 billion extra funding. West Cheshire may also have additional funding for extra GP and nurse bed appointments for 8 to 8, 7 days a week. The mandate is also around the improved NHS 111 services, so about an integrated urgent care service. The reason this has moved several times as well in its genesis is because over that time, various pieces of different guidance have come out from NHS England, including that about integrated urgent care services. And there is an absolute mandate about an urgent treatment centre that is on the Arrow Park site, because then that becomes coterminous with A&E and forms the front door for A&E. That then means to deflect people who whose clinical need means that they can be treated in a different way, not necessarily for A&E. Is there anything I missed there, Paula?
No, I think when you look at this, I mean, you sometimes if you're reading it just for the first time, or somebody new coming to this, it may appear that it's just the two options and that's it, take it or leave it. And actually, that's not what it is. What we've done is put out two proposals, but we have to be mindful of the funding that we have and the financial resources that we have to deliver this. So with an urgent treatment centre being mandated, the cost of that, then we have to look at what can we deliver within the community that is equitable for our patients across Wirral, because at the moment it's not equitable. And I know that, and as a doctor, I know that patients in West Wirral don't have the same